So, hello everyone. Thanks for joining this talk, especially so early in the morning. My name is Emmanuel Bouillon, and I'm going to discuss with you today some security issues that you might have to cope with when dealing with a federated identity. And more precisely, I'm going to discuss a specific type of federated identity, which is a SAML-based federated identity. So first, I'm an InfoSec guy, and more importantly, everything that I'm going to say today expresses only my own views, and especially do not involve any of my previous, current, and future employers. And everything is provided for educational purpose only. Okay, so that being said, here is the outline of this presentation. It's made of six parts. First, an introduction, what is it about and why should we care? In the second part, I'm going to discuss what is the problem we are trying to solve and how have we been doing it up to now. And then in the third part, I'm going to introduce some, not all, but some of the standards and specification around the federated identity area. And I'm just going to give the minimum material so that everybody will have in mind what is needed to take the most of the rest of the presentation. And the rest of the presentation is going to be made of two parts. One is how can we adapt classical web application scanner in order to have them better cope with the SAML-based, SAML-protected web applications. And in this part, I'm going to illustrate the type of results that this kind of tools can provide. And in the last part, I'm going to present and to discuss some security considerations and issues that we need to have in mind prior considering joining or creating such a federation. And finally, a conclusion. So let's get started. So SAML stands for Security Assertion Markup Language. And this talk is about SAML token and claims-based identity and access management. So I'm going to take a radically low-level approach of this protocol. That means I'm not going to discuss the API provided to developers in order to implement this kind of protocol. Maybe you're familiar with Windows Identity Foundation API, which is the .NET API that allows developers to somehow transparently integrate SAML protocols in their applications. So I'm not going to use this kind of level of abstraction, but I'm just going to look at the lowest level of those protocols. And also, this presentation is not about a consistent and formal study of every involved standard. I'm just going to cursorily introduce two of them, but you'll see that that's enough to get some interesting results. So basically, the approach I've been using is some sort of standards reverse engineering. Basically, find vulnerabilities and then go back into the specification and see why something got wrong. So what are going to be the takeaways of this presentation? First, adapted tools in order to have classical web application scanners to better cope with SAML-protected web applications. Then I'm going to demonstrate an assumption, which is that involved standards can be read as an attempt to circumvent the same origin policy. I'm going to show a demonstration about that. And finally, some important security considerations that you might have in mind before joining or creating such a federation. So why should you care? The thing is that the protocol and specification I'm going to discuss in this presentation are getting more and more prevalent. Actually, many influential major industrial players are currently pursuing the development of SAML-based protocol to achieve federated identity management. And also, it's support of federations that makes SAML particularly suitable for cloud deployment. That's why it's getting ubiquitous. So whether you like it or not, it's coming your way. And the last point is that depending on the context of deployment you're considering, be it business to business, banking, government for, let's say, tax payment, for instance, this kind of deployment and the associated security issues might entail some very thorny contractual, legal, and even privacy issues. That's why it's important to take care of that. So now, where do we come from? What is the main problem that this kind of standard tries to solve? Let's say that the single sign-on solution or issue within a single domain has been solved now for a while. So initial solution for this single sign-on problem in a single domain were very efficient from an administrator point of view, maybe not that satisfactory from a security point of view. Maybe some of you still have in mind the Sun Yellow Page solutions and the NIS system, for instance. So that was very interesting from an administrator point of view, but maybe not that interesting from a security point of view. So, but today, this problem has been solved by more robust protocols like Kerberos, for instance. Kerberos is a protocol you use very commonly to solve the single sign-on issue within a single domain. Typically, that's what you're using if you're using Active Directory environment. The thing is that now we need to solve this single sign-on solution, but between organizations, between different domains. And that's typically what SAML tries to solve. So the goal is to have a user and administrator-friendly cross-organization boundaries single sign-on. So here I'm going to focus on web applications. So that needs to be secure, scalable, easy to manage, and ideally taking care of privacy and anonymity issues. So this problem is not new, and of course previous solutions has already been deployed. Usually these solutions rely either on duplicating user accounts more or less intelligently, or by establishing trust relationships between security domains, typically Kerberos trust relationships between Active Directory domains, be it unilateral or bidirectional trust relationships. And of course, these type of solutions come up with some drawbacks, and that's this kind of drawbacks that SAML tries to solve and to tackle. And also regarding the problem of privacy and anonymity, some previous standards have been defined but never really been deployed nor widely adopted. So what do we need to know about federated identity standards? So in this part, I'm just going to give a very, very high level view of some of the involved standards around federated identity. So here you have a diagram that shows the complete ecosystems of specification around federated identity. As you can see, they are quite numerous, and most of them are supported by an organization called OASIS, the OASIS Consortium, which OASIS stands for Organization for the Advancement of Structured Information Standards. So I'm not going to discuss all of them, but just to introduce two of them. So first, the SAML specification, which in fact it's a set of specification in itself. And secondly, the WS Federation specification, which basically describes how to orchestrate flows in order to achieve this multi-domain single sign-on solution. So let's start with SAML. SAML stands for Security Assertion Markup Language, and basically it consists of building stone components, which once put together allow a given number of use cases to be supported. And these components primarily allow the transfer of identity information like authorization, attributes, and so forth between autonomous organizations that have an established trust relationship. That's the primary goal of SAML. And there is also something you need to know if you start looking at this kind of specification and document, that's the fact that there are some terms which have a specific definition in this context, so it's better to know their definition. So basically you have SAML assertions, SAML protocol, bindings, and profile. So SAML assertions, I'm going to go back to that later, but typically it's a signed XML document which contains statements about a principle, a user, for instance, that a given asserting party claims to be true. SAML protocol are basically the description of requests and response that are needed in order to obtain or to submit a SAML assertion. And SAML bindings are the mapping between SAML protocols and other layer of transport protocol. Typically, you have bindings for SAML and SOAP. You have the HTTP redirect binding and the HTTP post binding. And finally, you have what they called SAML profiles. which basically is the combination of assertions, protocol, and bindings in order to support a given number of use case or federated scenarios. So within the standard, there are several profiles defined like the web browser SSO profile or the single logout profile. I'm just going to mention two of them during this talk. First, the web browser SSO profile, because that's really the most common use case, the most widely used use case regarding SAML specification. And the second one is identity provider discovery profile. I'm going to mention this one because actually it is prone to some security issue. So what are SAML assertions? So as I said, SAML assertion is a signed XML document containing claims or attributes about a user. So and it's a set of claims contained in a SAML assertions that define the identity in regard to the what we call the relying parties. That means, let's say, the web application. So and what you need to have in mind also is that these claims do not need to be distinctive for this user. It doesn't have to be a login name, for instance, or things like that. It can just be a statement like, yes, this user has paid this monthly fee for the public library, or yes, this user is over 21. So here is how it looks like. So it's with no surprise, it's a signed XML document which follows the XML digital signature standard. So you get information regarding the issuer, regarding the signature, how it has been computed, etc. You get information about the subject, and more interestingly, you get information about the attributes contained within this SAML assertion. And typically, in the enterprise use case, these attributes are obtained from an enterprise directory that can be a group membership, yes, this user has this role in my organization, or yes, this user has this email address in my organization. And as you can see above, there is also some specific attributes that can be of interest, like the audience attribute. So the audience attribute is basically the statement that says for which relying party this SAML assertion has been made of. So that's interesting because that allows to prevent some SAML reuse attack. But for this to be effective, it needs to be taken into account by the relying party side of the implementation. And as we'll see later, it's not always the case. Some implementations do not verify that. And that's obviously a security issue. So how is SAML used? SAML is standard-based, so widely supported and supposedly interoperable between implementations. And the underlying standards include XML encryption, XML digital signatures, and X509 34 certificates. It heavily relies on HTTP for conveying the SAML assertion through the network, so that easily goes through firewall. There are several types of deployment. It can be deployed in a local network. It doesn't have to be in a federated environment. It supports branch offices deployment. It allows remote users to access the corporate network. But also, and more importantly, it supports federation and the federated scenario. And that's, I'm going to discuss that more into detail later. Into more detail later. And so basically the idea is to have a nice, neat, cross-domain, single sign-on solution so that users, our beloved users, are happy with their experience. So how does it work here? I'm going to focus on the web browser SSO profile. Basically, it's a four steps process. First, you have your user who requests access to a claims aware web application. And as this request do not contain any SAML assertion, the web application is going to redirect the web browser to the user's identity provider using the HTTP error code 302. And at this point, the user's identity provider is going to authenticate the user one way or another. We don't have to know the type of authentication that's going to be used at that point. It can be providing a login password or just using the corporate single sign-on solution, typically Kerberos-based. So once the identity provider has authenticated the user, then the identity provider is going to build a claim with appropriate attributes inside and sign it, and send it back to the user's browser with an HTTP POST form, with an auto-submit request to the web application. So that's how it's going to be transparently, this SAML assertion is going to be transparently sent back to the web application. And as this web application is claims aware, it's going to grant access to this user according to what is inside the claim, the SAML assertion. And that's how you achieve the single sign-on solution. So our users are happy with that. And that's really interesting from an administrator and developer point of view. Because in fact, from the web application side, you don't have to know and to deal with what kind of authentication mechanism has been used. So the corporate environment can completely change the way users are authenticated. The code of the web application still remains the same. That's what makes it really interesting from a developer point of view. So now you could say, so what? Because indeed, we have a single sign-on solution for web applications, but actually there are other ways to achieve that. Typically, you can use SPNIGO over GSS API with either Kerberos or NTLM as a security underlying party. So you could say, okay, why bother about that? So the main idea for that is that it supports federation, that is the sharing of identity between domains, what they call in the specification the multi-domain SSO issue. It also supports delegation, that's the maintenance of identity to backend services. And also, it provides an enhanced access control, which we call role-based access control. It's a very finer granularity regarding how you can provide access control to your web applications. And so that's it for SAML. So the second standard I wanted to introduce here is the WS Federation standard. So WS Federation is an approved OSI specification that defines mechanisms to allow different security realms to federate. So what does it mean? Basically, access to resources managed in one realm can be provided to users or principals whose identities and attributes are managed in other realms. So that's how you guarantee the fact that users' management stays on the side of their own authoritative domain. You don't have to bother about users' management of the other domain. So that's why it's really interesting. And also it includes mechanisms for brokering of identity, attribute, and authentication between realms. And in this document, in this specification, the last chapter is about security considerations. So it's a very small chapter, it's one page. And the last bullet of this chapter is about compromised services. And I'm mentioning it here because I'm going to get back to that later and see how this kind of consideration might really be an issue depending on the type of deployment you're considering. So here is basically how it works. So it's a very simple use case. So it starts by having your web browser, your client connected to web application. As you don't provide any claim to this web application, it's going to redirect you to its own identity provider. At that point, the target domain identity provider is going to redirect the browser to the user's identity provider. At that point, the user's identity provider is going to authenticate one way or another the user. And if once authenticated, the identity provider is going to retrieve some attribute, typically from an enterprise directory, build a claim, sign it, and send it back to the browser using a post redirect to be sent back to the identity provider of the web application. And at that point, the identity provider of the web application is going to, of course, verify the signature, and also possibly change, add, remove any attributes within the claim. Signed it and send it back to the web browser with a post redirect to the web application. At that point, the web application, which is going to receive this signed claim, this claim is signed by its own identity provider, so it's going to be trusted. And according to attributes contained in this claim, it's going to grant access to its resources. So that's basically how this multi-domain single sign-on solution at a very high level is achieved. And just to be complete, just be aware that there are, okay, I've just introduced a very simplest use case, but there are more complex architecture supported by the standard and the specification, and like typically what they call the brokered federations model, which basically is when you have a centralized identity provider, which is trusted by many others. And also, you, please be aware that users can have several identity providers depending on its context, and that's in some sort the users can have several identity and doesn't only have to trust one identity provider. So that's it about the introduction of the standards. Just to be complete, I've just added a list of what I consider as important security study, previous security study on that domain. So some security issues have already been discovered in regarding SAML. So either regarding SAML standards themselves or regarding some of their of SAML some SAML implementations. So now that's where things are getting interesting. When you look at the within the complete documentation of OASIS regarding SAML, there is one document called the SAML Technical Overview. So it's still a draft, but basically that's in the document where they explain all the rationale behind SAML. And what is really interesting at that point is that the really main driver, and that's how it is written in the document, the main driver for SAML is the limitations of browser cookies. And it's written like that. Typically, browser cookies are never transmitted over DNS domain. And basically, when you read that, you have the feeling that they consider that's quite sad. And SAML solves this problem. So, of course, the multi-domain single sign-on solution is a relevant and a legitimate issue to be solved. But on the other hand, if browser cookies do not fly between DNS domain, there are good reasons for that. And basically, it's part of the same origin policy. From a security point of view, what I mean here is that we could read that as, okay, SOAP sucks, let's build a workaround. So from a security point of view, there are this kind of consideration or of rationale has a great potential for security issues. So the question is it a fail or not? Typically, can a bad guy steal cookies? So I'm going to provide the response later, so you need to be patient. To conclude with this part, just a few words regarding implementation security. Typically for implementations I've been looking at like ADFS, Shibboleth, or SimpleSAML PHP, there are some good aspects, like the fact that by default tokens are encrypted, and by default also replay attacks are properly addressed. So you might also meet some problem regarding the compliance with the standards, like the fact that unsigned logout requests are accepted, or the fact that the target audience attribute is not verified. And finally, you also have some implementations which have some vulnerability, and I'm going to demonstrate two of them, an open redirection vulnerability and a cookie leak or a cookie theft within one implementation. So, before that, I'm just going to explain how to adapt our classical web application scanners in order to have them to properly cope with SAML-protected web applications. So, regarding our toolset, I think that these considerations have already been mentioned this morning by the presentation of related to SOAP and how to adapt web application scanners to better cope with to better assess web service based on SOAP. So, but typically, web application scanner toolset is made of several kind, a combination of different tools chosen by more or less objective criteria. So, typically, it can be made of professional or community edition of commercial tools like WebInspect, Acunetix, and others. You can use free and open source software for web application scanning, Skipfish, Nikto, and some Firefox plugins also. And also, very often, when you discuss with people doing that for a living, they very often use their own homemade custom scripts that they have been developing throughout their year of experience. Regarding methodology, it's a little bit of the same. Supposedly, some formal, more or less formal procedure are supposed to be followed. You can rely on some generally accepted best practices like the OWASP testing guide or the OSSTMM framework. But finally, it always heavily relies on habits and personal preferences. And also, still, many manual ad hoc and improvised steps are needed. So that's why I think we still need to adapt our toolset. Even though if some great presentation regarding how to do web application assessment states that we should not be a tool, the only tool which is really needed is our brain, I still think that properly using the right tool often makes a difference, especially because usually it's a time-constrained exercise. And regarding SAML, there are two reasons to adapt our toolset. The fact that it allows a traditional assessment of web application scanner to cope with SAML token, to cope with SAML protected web applications. And also, these kind of applications and their security very often relies on very complex configuration settings. So we need, these configurations are prone to error, and we need tools to assess that the good configuration settings are effectively in place. So the thing is that there are already some existing tools that can help the web application scanner, the web application pen tester when they have to cope with SAML. So I've listed some of them here, at least all those I know of. So you've got the Uninet SAML Tracer, which actually is a Firefox plugin which allows you to see decoded SAML token that your browser is receiving and sending. You have the SAML debugger, the FIDO SAML debugger. It's an online application that allows you to submit a token, either encoded or decoded, and then you receive the answer, which is either decoded or encoded. And the last one is really an interesting one. It is provided by DN3 Identity Federation, part of their initiative called Federation Lab. Basically, it's an online automated checks of service provider implementation. So if you have a SAML implementation of the service provider side, you can trust the Federated Lab STS, and then online start ask a scan of your implementation, and then you're going to get a result of how compliant is your implementation regarding the standard. So I'm going to show you the result of this kind of scan just later, and of course you can always use a manual approach to encode and decode SAML token. So here you can see an example of a report from a Federation Lab service provider tester. So I've just installed an out-of-the-box Hello World application using Simple SAML PHP, which is one implementation of SAML standards. So the good news is that you have many success, so that means somehow some compliances with the protocol, but you also get some errors regarding these compliances, like the fact that indeed unsigned single logout requests are accepted, and that the targeted audience attribute is not checked by the service provider side, which is in fact a security issue. So we still need to adapt our toolset, and there is one area where this adaptation is proved to be very, very useful. It's when encoding and decoding SAML token. And the gain of this encoding and decoding touches several parts of the assessment of the efficiency of the web application scanner. First, having access to clear to this SAML token, or having access to the SAML token decoded, allows you to really more accurately understand the meaning of all these requests and what these tokens are made for, what are the attributes involved, for which relying parties. So that helps understanding what is going on. Also, it allows you to do some more relevant request mangling. And if your web application scanner happens to be a fuzzer, then instead of fuzzing a big chunk of meaningless data, you're going to fuzz properly, more accurately, each specific parameters. And also, it allows you to thwart some anti-replay safeguards, like the fact that you need to change random numbers on each different request. And it allows you also to update timestamp on the fly, which then allows you to have longer scans to unfold properly, which avoids some false negative results. So here is the approach I've been using. So it's not a new approach, because typically it has already been used by people from JDS security when they have been assessing the Microsoft proprietary binary encoding of SOAP requests for WCF. So the idea is to chain proxies. So first you have a pre-processing proxy, whose role is to decode requests and encode responses. the middle proxy is actually your real scanner when you have when you do your real let's say assessment, and when your intelligence as a pen tester takes place, and then you have the post processing proxy which encode the request back and decode the response back. So this way, the application still receives the request in the proper expected format, so can work properly. So to implement that, I've been using Burk ProSuite. So I guess most of you know this web assessment tool. It has a very, very good cost-benefit ratio. And what is really interesting with this tool is that it provides a Java API to extend Burk Suite functionalities. And it's particularly suitable for pre- and post-processing. And also, there exist some bindings both for Python and Ruby. So I've been using the Ruby framework to extend Burk Suite, which is called Bubby. Recently, a very complete tutorial has been presented and is available on the net. And for this kind of tool, you only need to hook either event proxy message or even HTTP message. So the proof of concept I've been developing is freely available at this URL, and you can use and test it basically to retrieve all the results I'm going to present now. So I'm not going to discuss the code itself, just going to show you how it looks like. So here is a pre-processing proxy which receives the initial browser request. So as you can see, or maybe you can just guess that you see a SAML token, an encoded SAML token, so very difficult to understand. And this pre-processing proxy is going to edit this request and decode the SAML token. So now you have in the edited request the complete decoded SAML token, which is sent to your middle proxy, which is actually your real web application scanner. So typically, if you're using Burp as a middle proxy, then you can send this request to Burp intruder, for instance, to have specific parameters to be mangled with. And at that point, the middle proxy is going to send this request like that, and to the post-processing proxy, which will receive the decoded token in clear, if you want. And then the post-processing proxy is going to encode the SAML token back to the appropriate format, so that it's going to be sent to the application as it expects to be sent. So that's basically how it works. So I'm just going to illustrate some results you can obtain using this approach. So I've chosen two results to illustrate these tools. And I've chosen these two because actually these results and these vulnerabilities are more vulnerabilities related to standards and specifications themselves than to related to implementation. So that was more interesting and more fun to discuss these two vulnerabilities. So the first one is an open redirection. So an open redirection is just the fact that you can craft a request so that the target is going to respond with a redirection to another site which is controlled by the attacker, right? So it's not critical, and as you're going to see, it's somehow built in the SAML standards. And then I'm going to illustrate how this can lead to a cookie theft. That means that we are going to be able to make cookies fly between a DNS domain using this kind of vulnerabilities. So basically, if you visit his site, a bad guy can inconspicuously discover your identity provider. That means what is your originating organization? So that's at least a privacy issue. So to demonstrate that, I've been leveraging an existing live open to everyone test environment, which is provided by the Norwegian Academic Federation. It's called OpenIDP. And I've been using a dummy account. And the cookie I'm going to steal actually is HTTPS openidp.fido.no. So what you're going to see is a complete four-step SAML authentication, right? And then you'll see how a bad guy can just steal this cookie. So it's a three-step process. First, the victim accesses the bad guy site. And this site contains a craft GET request to the service provider, which will actually leverage the open redirection vulnerability to get back to send back the cookie to its own controlled website. So to make it more visual, this redirection will not go to the bad guy website, but I've crafted a Google search request using as an argument the cookie, so that you can see that indeed the cookie is appended to the Google search request. So let's see. So at the beginning, you're going to see that this is the open redirection vulnerability. So I don't know if you see anything, but basically here you see that it's a GET request that goes to openidp.fido.no, and when you click on this link, you're going to be automatically redirected either to Google or to DEF CON website. So that's a Google redirection. Then you have the same thing with so this request goes to OpenIDP and gets redirected to DEF CON. So that's just the open redirection vulnerability, so nothing very critical. But then, let's imagine that your user is connecting to a service provider that uses SAML and OpenIDP as its identity provider. So here, this is a service the relying party, which is called veryopenid.net. I choose my identity provider. Then automatically, I get redirected to my identity provider. I need to authenticate, so here by using a login password. And then you'll see that this identity provider is going to craft a SAML request and send back to the application so that I get authenticated. So that's the four-step process you have been describing. And now, if you click on the malicious link, you'll see that the redirection end up with the theft of the cookie. Right? So that's the demonstration. I hope that's clear. So that's how you can steal a cookie and make cookie flies between DNSDOM using this kind of vulnerability. So the thing is that actually, if you go back to the standard, these vulnerabilities are not implementation issue, but more specification issue, because it comes from the identity provider discovery service profile, and actually it's built in. The open redirection, when you look at the standard, it's written like that. The open redirection is in the specification. And actually, when they wrote this specification, they somehow felt that there was a kind of issue. Typically, this is a quotation of the standard. This protocol had the potential for creating additional opportunity for phishing. So at least they were aware that it was dangerous. And they proposed a workaround based on the service provider metadata, but it's only should workaround, and there's no way on. They don't explain how we could exchange metadata between the service provider and the discovery service. So basically, the developer have just implemented properly the standard, and they get vulnerable. So that's what I wanted to show you about this part. And the last part is about consideration regarding the design of consideration about the deployment and trust topologies. So as you remember, this is the simplest use case of federation scenario. So you have two organizations with a trust relationship. But of course, there are more complex deployment scenario. So the question is, does this kind of deployment really implement new risk? It's a contentious issue, but basically, other solutions are not that more secure. So that's, to be simple, that's what we can say about that. So here is a very simple deployment scenario. You have one organization which tries to access another organization application, and the access control is based, for instance, on the user's email address. So, and typically, what happens in real life is that you have several domains. Organization B has several customers accessing its application. So now the question is, what if one of the organizations gets either malicious or compromised? Typically, what if organization C signs a claim for a user of organization B? The thing is, by default, if you installed everything by default, this is going to work. That means that your application is going to grant access regarding the attribute which is in the claim, because from a signature point of view, everything is fine. So you need to implement yourself all the business checks at that point that will prevent this kind of attack to be working. But that's not, you need to do that. That's not implemented by default. But at least in this simple scenario, you can do it. You still can do it. The thing is, there are more complex scenarios and more realistic scenarios where it's getting more complicated. Typically, when you have an indirect trust relationship, where you have a central trust broker that conveys trust between organizations. So at that point, so here is how it works. You've got one organization which trusts organization D, which then is trusted by organization B. So, and then you have this single sign-on solution that works perfectly fine the same way flowing between these three organizations. Now the question is, what if organization C signs a claim for a user which is not part of its own organization? Let's say, what if organization C gets either malicious or compromised? The thing is, in this case, if organization B do not do its job by checking everything that needs to be checked and which is not done by default, then organization B has no way to see the trick and to see that things got wrong. So if the STSD signs the token, then STSB has no way, as an organization, organization B has no way to see that something went wrong. So that means that, in fact, organization B fully relies on organization D to properly check SAML claims. But so that means that then what is the policy for that? Do we have a way to verify? Is auditing permitted, etc.? And how to prove other parties' compliance with relevant requirements. So that's typically the questions that are usually unasked and even less answered. So the bottom line is, what about a malicious or compromised ADP in a federation? And can a malicious ADP impersonate another domain's users? That's really the bottom line issue. And is there any safeguards in place? That means business checks that prevent that. And who own this safeguard? Do you, as an organization, own this safeguard, or do you, due to the fact that it's a trust, an indirect trust topology, do you delegate this kind of safeguards? So that's in fact, because when you look at implementation, by default, these safeguards are not implemented. And if you get back to the standards and FEL, actually, this kind of consideration has just been cursorily mentioned in the bullet I mentioned previously, which is the compromised services. And indeed, they recognize that this is really a very major issue when you have this third-party broker trust relationship. But on the other hand, in practice, it works by default. And there are no proposed solutions on how to prevent that. So in the case of a third-party broker trust, you need to control the loss of controls. That means whose liability is involved, etc. What are other parties' obligations? And that's the concept I've called SAML claims laundering. So all relies on the checks made at each level. This must be done since default settings are permissive. So typically, ways to do that is to have key attributes which are kept or added to avoid the turning the situation into a blind trust to this organization D part. And the thing is also, when on main federations, when you join a federation, usually you don't have access to this policy. So you don't know exactly what checks are in place. And that's an issue. So that ends up this presentation. So the main takeaways of this presentation are, first, knowledge and tools to keep on properly assessing SAML protective web application, how to adapt the tool sets, classical web application scanner tester tool set to cope with SAML protective web application. Then proven assumption that the fact that standards can be read as an attempt to circumvent the same origin policy. So you've got the tools and process to go there. And also important security design consideration. The thing is that without taking care, insecurity by design is possible. And typically when you have a cross-domain trust relationship with Active Directory, for instance, if one domain gets compromised, this domain cannot impersonate other domains' users. Whereas with a SAML indirect trust implementation, it's possible by default. So you need to take care of that. With SAML SAML-based cross-domain SSO, by default, this kind of situation will occur. Of course, this approach applies to other forms of delegation of a federation. In this field, developers and marketers are ahead of security guys, so yet default security settings are not secure. So the make it working approach might lead to insecure deployment, and that's why we need to keep up with this kind of protocol to avoid big deployment security failure and post-mortemly discover that there has been an issue. So we need to get acquainted with the involved protocols to properly assess the design and the deployment of such a federation, and also adapt our tool set, because probably bad guys will. And very probably also that would be helpful to have better guidance or improved standards on how to protect to avoid this kind of issue, because today it really relies on diligent administrators and developers to implement these checks. But if we had a common way to solve this kind of issue, then even in terms of assessing, it could be far more easier. I guess that's all I have for today. So I'd like also to thank one of my great colleagues, which is called Rui Fisk, for his great help and extensive knowledge on SAML. And if you have any question, I can try answering them now, or I will be in room 2 Q&A. Thanks a lot for your attention.